evang me sutang ekang samayang bhagava kuru suviharati kammasa dhammang.
Well, good morning, everyone. Lovely to see you all. We'll just begin by a very short homage. Namo dasa bhagavato arhato samma sambuddhasa. Namo dasa bhagavato arhato samma sambuddhasa. Namo dasa bhagavato arhato samma sambuddhasa. So I'm always struck by Lord Buddha's proliferate teachings and his very many different ways of addressing different people in different situations, what's called upaya, his skillful means, and his endless compassion to teach for so many years in so many different places. And we are still benefiting from that teaching more than 2,500 years later. And then I often wonder, how long will the Buddha Sasana last? How many more people will benefit from it? Because that compassion that started, you know, it's flowing on, and how far will it flow on into the future? So when he saw his own and others' past lives, and then he realized the suffering in each of them, and then realized the law of karma, the cyclical nature and how beings are trapped, he then found a way out, as we know, so that people could become free from suffering. When I reflect, sometimes I get these visions of, you know, beings in the world coming and going, and each one performing their own performance on the life's stage, which for me is just a little sketch of many levels of beings. Many of us, we come, we are born, grow, and learn things, and then pass on. And so many other different kinds of beings come, and we all perform our own little dance and then leave the stage. And we can see so many rhythms all around us, meeting and parting, happiness and sorrow, and minute by minute, day by day, all constantly changing, giving a very rich rhythm to all the lives that are here. So within that, the common grounds that are linking all these performances is probably what it's a bit like the principles or Dhamma aspects. And maybe when we are looking at Dhamma, it's asking us to see the true nature of what goes on for all beings in, as a general principle. We start with looking at our own rhythms and then realize that the next sort of life rhythm is supported by the rhythm of breathing. And a lot of us might have started meditation with noticing the rhythms of breathing, and later on see that there are layers that we look into more and more that open out the body, the feelings, moods and things as states, and all the conditions that give flavors or color these different layers that open out. They're all conditions coming together and going, and we continue jumping from one to the other. So the first layer is very obvious because we are here now, and we know the basic needs that help us to live in this world, you know, the things that support us. We need food to live, apart from the breathing, of course. We need food to breathe as well. And we need breathing to have food, so they are interrelated. And then we need something to cover ourselves with, clothes to keep warm, and also protect our body, and then shelter to stay somewhere, to have a rest, to live. And then we need medicines if we get ill. And the Buddha calls these the four requisites for bhikkhus. It can also mean meditator, because a person who wishes to, you know, find a way out of suffering has the intention of not necessarily just being enclosed by our home life, but perhaps we want to look somewhere further, not necessarily become homeless by wearing robes and things, but in our attitude of searching something for more than what's in our home. You could say, as Achancha says, the inner home. So when these four essentials are missing for anyone, including ourselves, then there is suffering at a very obvious level. And the response of the heart at the time is to do something about it. And that's the obvious kind of compassion where people give things to others for these requisites, you know. And the second layer, which is feelings and moods and mind states, is slightly obvious to some extent in life too, because we are aware of our ups and downs, and then we interact with others or with the world around us, and how all these things are part of our life as well. Sometimes when there's difficulties in these two areas, then sadness and depression can come as well, or anxiety, also so slightly other kind of suffering, which I'm sure we're all aware of to some extent. And we're aware of it in ourselves, and we're also aware of it, it happens for others. And again, there are many ways that, you know, we support each other by listening or sharing something. And there's professionally as well, people have hospitals and care industries and so on, where a lot of people work to help each other. And that's obviously compassion-based, although some people's motives might be something different, we don't know. But it certainly involves caring with a good heart. And there are jara marana soka parideva dukkha domna sopayasa in that cycle of dependent origination, which means we're aware that things change and things die, are maturing, there's an aging process, there's a decaying process, and there's grief and sorrow that comes. And then there could be distress or anxiety and despair. And then there's also separation from what we wish to have or we had, and it goes off, goes away. Or not getting what we want to have, you know. And then also, he says, in short, it's all connected with our five khandhas, the five aspects which are supposed to help us be a human being, our bodies and feelings and our perceptions of views and our plans and activities, sankharas, and consciousness. So we might not always be aware of them in a very obvious way at first, but perhaps when people begin to investigate Dhamma and meditate and so on, we might become more aware of it. Or perhaps we already do if we experience these things in a very extreme way in our lives. The Buddha is asking us to know them and recognize and understand how they happen, so we can find ways for them not to happen again or not to cause suffering again. And these can unfold for us, as I said, you know, in a deeper way when we at different times in our lives. And I call all this sort of when we practice and study and then work with Dhamma things, Dhamma practice. So in the subtitle, I said Dhamma practice, because the Buddha has said, you know, you listen to Dhamma or good of given by him, a person who knows it, and then we listen to it. And it doesn't actually have to be a Buddhist person. You know, there's a lot of people who know truth in different ways and they express it. And so we listen to that. So, and then we listen with the sutta minyana. So while listening, we get some kind of knowing. And then when based on that, we may then, you know, consider it more and ponder about it. That's chinta minyana, discuss with others and so on. Then we find ways of living with it, bhavana minyana, in our life. And all of these need only one thing, and that, he says, is yoniso manasikara, you know, skillful attention. And I really find this word quite amazing, because manasikara is attention is something we need for everything in our life. You know, in the Abhidhamma, it's a universal quality. But yoniso means skillful. It also means knowing how things come and go, where they come from, because yoni also means womb, the origin of things, and how we are making of all of it in our mind. So that sort of to me is like Dhamma practice or Dhamma investigation. And we are doing this when we read or when we listen or, you know, all those kinds of activities. So skillful attention would also mean opening up to something without having any expectations or assumptions and without choosing this or that. So being opening up with trust, really. And also, if it's very difficult to hear what we're listening, then having an attitude of some kind of compassion and protection in ourselves as well, with kindness, but not with harsh judgments, even to ourselves. You know, I'm not being good enough for something. And doing all the practice or this Dhamma work, when people choose to do this path, sometimes, certainly I found this in my life, you can become very serious. We take ourselves very seriously and whatever we are doing. And, you know, when you first begin to practice, you want to do it nearly every day. If you can't do it, it's really annoying and so on. And I remember when we start, the group of us who sort of started around early 70s together, we might have been becoming like that. I don't know. Maybe Lance noticed something like that. Anyhow, there was a time he asked those of us who were there that he suggested that all the women should learn to dance some, and men should also learn some dancing, you know, separate, just to dance and have fun. And there was a bit of reluctance. So it's just part of meditation, really. You know, but we did, you know, a lot of us did gradually. That was very interesting because the effect was that that sense of seriousness, I think it opened up, and there was a lot more joy and just, you know, doing things together, which were very different from studying and sitting and meditating, had the effect of communicating with each other in a different way. And I became aware that there was a little bit more laughter even in the group meetings. It obviously then begins to affect the practice. And you know that if you're doing something beautiful and lovely, either by yourself or with others, it has an effect on your practice. And when practice is something deep and lovely, it has an effect on our life. They are related. Or if we're feeling really tired and awful, but in our mind, we're feeling quite peaceful, it doesn't always have to be exactly mirroring, then we realize, oh, you know, what is it? Why am I feeling tired? So it could be just a need of rest or food or something like that. So they are helping us to learn how these aspects work in us and are interrelated and affect each other. And when we become aware of the good and not so good feelings and the good and not so good effects, then begin to choose more of the good, is what Buddha calls a skillful kusala. I don't like to say akusala bad, because it just means not, so it's not so good, I feel. You know, it could be really bad, but I think it's more like, you know, we do things which have good effect and some that doesn't really have such good effect. And there's a differentiation of kuso and not kuso. Kuso can also mean it's health. So, you know, it's a healthy attitude of mind or a health in the body or a blameless action, which leads to merit, punya. And I know people often think punya is like offering dana and so on. When there's this skillful attitude, it leads to blameless action, which is punya, which is meritorious. And I sort of think maybe the translation for punya could be goodness, some sense of goodness, you know, because it's a freedom from distress at that time. And also with kusa, that is connected with kusa, connected with wisdom. So some kind of knowing, maybe not always, but it has that potential in it. So as kusa increases in life, you know, more energy can come, more brightness of mind. So these two relationships between our inner world and an outer world, it's like there are these two realities, and we need to live with skillfulness in each of them, because we want to be at ease in this normal life, our normal reality, conventional reality, if you like, and enjoy and, you know, find ways of earning money and so on. And we also then learn to live at ease when what we could call the ultimate reality or our inner world. So I made this creative sort of image. You know, I had this aspect of the path going on, gradually developing, and there's the whole world around. So it has this aspect of life, and as it has Bodhi leaves, the potential for wisdom. So, you know, it has aspects of age. But as the path gradually develops, first we're sort of interlinking these, I've drawn four aspects, because, you know, four truths and many folds. But also it progresses towards something. But after some time, we also interact with the world with that, you know. So the world which is conventional out there, and the world which is with practice and so on, could begin to open out, so that there's a sort of relationship going on between the two. It also has this very beautiful energy. So if you want to learn a skill like a dance in this conventional world, or a skill like meditation in the other world, they also have similar strands in them. And so we both need the skill of a sati, you know, of staying with what we're doing and keeping in touch with it. And we have the attitude to attend to it in a positive way. Sometimes now people say we can be mindful of things. So when we are mindful of things, it is possible after some time, you know, it's like there's a mindfulness and of something else, sort of separation. And it could be a very subtle trap of becoming an observer, how I'm living in life, or how to do rather than actually doing. So I think that's why the mindfulness has this partner of sampajanya, sometimes it's called clear comprehension and alertness of something. And we could say that it's almost like being mindful with something rather than of something. And we know how this being, when we are with something, we can know how it affects us. We can know what's going on when I am in that situation. So we begin to become a bit more aware of other things that are going on in that state of mindfulness. And staying with what we are mindful with, placing our attention firmly there and know something more, is quite important. So I think the process of this sampajanya is like the beginning of awareness, sati sampajanya. And then the knowledge of it, the knowing of it, is a gradual opening out of something. So first there's knowledge, and then after some time, the Pali words avabodha, that you know, we begin to try and make sense of it, begin to try and understand it, and then gradually avabodha evolves into some kind of jnana, knowing something in a deeper way, knowing what we're doing connected with our own situation. And as that matures and we begin to notice similar things outside in other people's and other situations, perhaps gradually it becomes wisdom then, you know. So if we just say, oh, wisdom, it sounds like slightly high, inaccessible to me anyway. But there is this gradual process going on, and the wisdom aspect would be seeing how things work and how we are lifting our attention out of ourselves and beyond facts and personal experiences to understand connectedness and to understand principles of things, and then how to use them. So we're sort of learning to go beyond our own views and beyond our own world. And once we know these interconnected processes, we can see the cause and effect more clearly, and we can see the sticking points, you know, the difficulties more clearly that cause dukkha. And then we can find a way out of it. So what I think from, you know, when people feel they want to be compassionate, that we want to do something for others. But here, first of all, we need to learn to have compassion for ourselves. And we know we can get stuck, and we know how to find some solution either by ourselves or ask for help. And that is sort of also cultivates humility. You know, when we know what we don't know is the beginning of right view. Because if we think we know everything, then we will never find out more, will we? So right view starts getting stronger as well. And we can see this in any aspect of life, not just learning the skill, whatever we are doing. In our actions, in our speech, in our thoughts. And as this matures, we could say what Buddha calls conscience, hiri, you know, a sense of self-respect, a sense of wishing to do that which leads towards kusla, towards goodness. Or because we know the cause and effect and the results of actions, wishing not to do things which are causing harm, which is called otapa. And the Buddha says these are like the two guardians of our world. In the Samadhiti Sutta, he says, when you want to begin to purify, develop right view, complete our view of how things are, we need to begin by strengthening these two guardians of our world, the hiri and otapa, or conscience and awareness of consequences. And then he says, after that, also we really need to know, or as well as, maybe not as a sequence, how that karma happens, you know, that our results do produce an effect. I mean, they're related, aren't they? That's why otapa comes. And all this we can recognize as what is called sila, our behavior and how we live in the world and how we are connecting to each other. And we know that there are training rules for purifying our sila, our behavior, as sometimes as 5 or 8 precepts, to do 3 of them to do with our body, of how not harming others. So that's the base for metta, and not taking what's not given, which is a base for generosity, and then being respectful to human beings, to other beings, and that's the base for not having sexual misconduct. And then there are the 4 aspects of speech, of not lying and not causing schism or separation, you know, idle chatter and gossip. And those things are the verbal interactions, but there's also the inner verbal interactions going on. We are all aware of those. So it's not necessarily outer these things, you know, but also the inner ones going on. And then all these 10 are called kammapathas, courses of karma. So behind those are the 3 roots or the 3 bases of either greed or not greed, either dislike and resistance or not dislike. And then there's either delusion or not so deluded, more wakefulness. So these 10 are quite important as a base, but it doesn't have to be the way we start, but it does emerge when we practice and become more aware. But some people might already naturally be there. For most human beings, there is some of it there, but we might not realize those levels of the mind, you know, that they are coming from. So all that is perfection of that sila khanda, development of right speech, right action, and right way of living. Also, in one sense, sila is therefore an aspect of sati and sampajanya, mindfulness, clear comprehension as well, because it is about being aware of things in relation to where we are. So Lord Buddha could recollect his past lives and others' past lives and to know these things. And I am not sure if we feel we might not believe in past lives, and if we do, whether we can recollect them as well. But we can all recollect this life and when we were born and various things might have happened and how they had an effect. And maybe it's one of those things, either consciously or not consciously, that led us to seeking a wish to practice. So we, most of us here, started with meditation practice on breathing mindfulness. There are many other methods of doing anapanasati, breathing mindfulness practice, and samatha is one of them. What the Buddha says is that when we develop mindfulness of breathing, it also then supports the four foundations of mindfulness. So, and that would support the making stronger the bhujangas, the awakening qualities. And those would then lead to having the path become more clear for us. This is Anapanasati Sutta in relation to the four foundations of mindfulness. When I first saw this many years ago, I really got interested in knowing it would be possible to interlink them, develop them purposefully or consciously. So the first ones are to do with breathing in long and out long and breathing out short and out short. And in those first two, in the suttas, he says no, because he says bhajanati, which means get to know its nature, get to know how it comes and goes and the effects it has and so on, and how it's connected to the wide world. And then he changes to sikkhati, which is training. Knowing that, we train ourselves, we train our mind, experiencing the body and the body activities, which is sankharas, you know, that are changing, becoming aware of those changing. And then that is supposed to fulfill the first foundation of mindfulness called kaya. Now, kaya is sometimes called body, but it doesn't mean just this physical body. It means things that heap up and become a body. And it's continuously changing and it becomes, as the breathing shows, and it affects our body. And then the second section is all about training to do with our energy, joyful energy, piti, sukha, and experiencing the activity of the mind, which I sometimes take as maybe either going towards peace or the hindrances that come, all those activities that happen in our mind. And then when they become calm, or when our attitude to them becomes calm and we don't get distracted with those activities, and that's to develop the foundation of Vedana, of feeling. And the next one's about mind, where the fourth one in the feeling one could be beginning of, you know, entering jhana states and so on. And those are to do with knowing mind states. And when the mind state in the fourth section of that is a bit more freed, then it becomes a possible to become free of being stuck in worlds and examining further. So the mind states to me is sort of also a transition point, because it says in the when there is complete sukha pramodaya, then that's like the jhana where you can rest and abide in a happy way. The last one's about Dhamma, which we'll come back to later. So I was very conscious of this, and you know, in the sutta, when first heard the Satipatthana Sutta, the foundations for mindfulness, practicing it and becoming aware of those four places of body, feeling, and then mind, and the Dhammas. There weren't too many at the time, not very clear about many things that were also possible. One of the things that was really striking in the sutta is it says internal and external and both. And I think, what does that mean? Does it mean my own and others and then both? So took it like that at first. And it's sort of quite nice, because we become aware of these, not just in me, but in everybody. And it's ground for metta and compassion and so on. A few years ago, I came across this book by Achandi Damodaro, and he gives a bit more guidelines on how to practice these. And he calls them the four frames of reference, which I quite like, because the frames of reference are like they're like an inner map. And he says we need to use them as a means of steadying our mind and stand firm in the frame each time when we want to do that. And the one aspect which again was newish is the word atapi, which in English is translated ardent. So at first, ardent to me means, you know, with full effort kind of thing. Also, ardent means continuously being aware, you know, without a sustained effort. And for me, a sustained effort doesn't mean we have to work hard all the time, but we maintain something. And it helped to practice further. Just around 4 years ago, I met some lay Sri Lankan practitioners in the Ketumati Vihara in Manchester. And I could see that when they talked about Dhamma, something was there in a way which I couldn't put my finger on, but I knew it was something more than what I knew, or different. I don't know if more, but certainly different. And it seemed that I needed to know about it. So I asked if I could join in their discussions and so on. And they practiced by listening to the Pali chant and then meditating for a while and then seeing what the words might mean. I like, exploring the words and all the meanings it has anyway. So it really suited me. And I find that each word, the Buddha says this one word, but of course he's addressing so many different kinds of people. And every person feels as if he's talking with them. So each word must have many different levels of meaning. So when this came, this opportunity, I really enjoyed it. And this last year, I invited one of those people to come and teach the Satipatthana Sutta here. And I thought it might be nice to share a little bit of it, because it is so long. So I'm just going to share the bits that I found were more, if you like, or different from what I knew before. If it's not your way of listening to all these words and things, obviously, you know, allow them to just nourish and do your practice of breathing, or however you want to be aware. So the sutta is the Mahasatipatthana Sutta from the Digha Nikaya. It's the long discourse on how to develop these four frameworks. So this I'm going to have to read some of my notes, because it's still fairly new practice for me. I'll say the Pali and the English words just because of that aspect of how the words can lead into things. The person who was teaching, he said that what the Sutta is sort of, or the Buddha is doing, he's helping us to come to a sort of aspect of samadhi while we're listening. And when we are in that, then taking us a bit further and to help us to see how the process is with some kind of insight, how it's working, and to develop some kind of understanding about it. And even the start, when we read the start, evang me sutang ekang samayang bhagava, is usually a start of that, because the Ananda is saying that. When the Buddha is saying evang me sutang, it's like, I am the person who is ready to listen. This is what I am hearing. You know, the verb doesn't matter if it's past or not, but we're getting ready to listen to something. And this sense of readiness, ekang samayang, now it's not at one time, it's now, it's not the past, which is very refreshing, because we're not reading about something, like we're listening to something which is possible right now. So it says, ekang samayang, this, now in this moment, bhagava. And you say the word bhagava, you say, the Buddha's here, you know, in this moment, when we're listening to Dhamma, Buddha is here. And we wake up to that. And then it says, Kuru Sivi Harati Kama Sadamang Nama. this way, where this sutta was given. We don't have to worry about whether we know it or not, but this is where the sutta is happening. This is Kuru Siviharati, where we are now, right now, in this cyberspace, is Kuru Siviharati. And Kama Sadamang, the work, the Kama for that is to do something with Dhamma. It's like we are now, the name of it is this village here, that we're ready to do some Kama in relation to Dhamma, some work in relation to Dhamma. So this is a specific place we have in ourselves now, ready. And then the Buddha says, he addresses us directly. He says, Tatra ko bhagava bhikkhu amantesi. He asks us, can you imagine? You're sitting here. And the Buddha comes and he says, I'm going to say something to you. So he's addressing us, that he's going to tell us something. And we have a choice to wake up to it, to pay attention to it. And he says, bhikkhavo, directly, you know, meditators. And we reply, badante, yes. You know, we choose to pay attention, so we are listening. So we're going to hear all these words in a little while in the chanting. And then he gives a summary of what he's going to tell us, which is Udeso. He's keying us into the main Dhamma points that he's going to show, the core of it first. And he says, Ekai no mago, that there is this direct path. Sometimes people say ekam one, but he's not saying one in the sense that it's wrong if you say this is the only way, but it's direct. And this is a direct path that leads us out of suffering, he says. At the moment, working with the Samyutta Nikaya, and in that, there's a sutta where he, when he's much older, just, you know, before, a few months before his parinibbana, he goes into solitude to meditate. And then when he is meditating, he comes out and he says, I have realized without a doubt that this is the direct path. So that's very interesting. So you can imagine him wondering, you know, but what else he might want to say. And that's one of the things he says about it. And then he says, Ayang Bhikkhave Mago, and this path, encouraging us, you know, to relax and listen. Satanam. Sata usually is translated being, but satanam can also mean anyone who is stuck inside, you know, the sattas, the beings, we are stuck inside and we are looking for a way out, but we can't see what's happening. So, because atta in ourselves is stuck. So, satana means we are stuck in our being. And visuddhiya is that we can get out of suffering. So visuddhiya is often, you know, we can purify and get out. And he shows us some, to now raise our awareness, he shows us these aspects of dukkha, so suffering a little bit, to encourage us to want to do this work. And he says, Soka paridevang, so there's sorrow, there's stress, and we get this feeling that we can't get something sometimes. And then something which was great is not so great anymore. So we get parideva, you know, that wishing to have something we don't have anymore. And then he says, Samati kamaya, that these are all illusions, they are not real, and we can go past them, seek a way out. Again, more about dukkha, dukkha domnasa atta gamaya. So there's a physical and mental suffering that's there. There are things that are coming and going, and they are not satisfactory. And, you know, why are they not satisfactory? So sometimes you can think of an example. So one example is that you want to get something, you know, say a car or a dress or something, and we have a mental image of what I'm going to get, and then try and find that, and it doesn't match this mental image, and that causes suffering. Have you experienced that? So, you know, you feel a bit dissatisfied or a bit frustrated. So then he says, there is a way to get out. Naya is a way, and Adigamaya, to lift ourselves out of it. And he says, when we allow our consciousness to travel around freely in the whole range of all the past things where we can get stuck, you know, we compare with memories of something or the future things, an image I have of what I want, there's a way out of that process. So that's quite sort of a relief and encourages us to do more. And then the last one is Nibbana Sachikiriyaya. Well, does that mean Nibbana, you know, as enlightenment? As you know, Nibbana has many meanings, and in a moment it could be that momentary calm or peace or freedom. So Sachikiriyaya, we can realize it momentarily at least. And Yadidang Chataro Satipatthana. And what is it? In fact, this person said, if we can't imagine or recollect that moment, think of a time when you're really quite not happy, and then suddenly you have the first moment of happiness. But don't go to the next one. In that moment, what do you experience? And it could be just a little space of peace. And it's a bit like, that's the time to have our aim. Is that what you want to do more of? He said, which I found very helpful. And then he said, what are these? What is the way? And there are these four satipatthanas, these four frames of reference. This is what we need to do to find our way out. And then he explains the method after that. Of course, using sati on attention on what is happening, to be present at that moment. The intention is to cultivate awareness and to return to it, not once, but again and again and again, moment by moment, with an attitude of undertaking to find out the process. So that is not just being aware of that thing, but the attitude and the wish or the intention, if you like, one of those paramis of adhitana, you know, the strong wish to do something. So it's an attitude to cultivate awareness and to find out the process without judging, and to develop a steady sense of continuing to do that. Atapi, isn't it? The continuous sustained effort. So if we don't hold on to something, we don't allow ourselves to become a slave of what's happening, but we can become, for example, sorrow, and then we can become out of it like a master and investigate it with it. So we need to sort of separate a little bit from the process, away from being a slave and overcome by something, to becoming the master of it with the intention to investigate it, get to know what's causing this suffering all the way, many times in different states, all the way towards enlightenment, really, towards knowing the asavas, the taints. And at the time we might react to something. So it's like not having a reactive attention. And because it's a moment by moment, we are going through the range. There's the body, the feeling, mind, dhammas. You're having a continuous flow as well of awareness. And then this will allow us to see what is happening in our mind. Remember, we're building a skill here, a kuso, you know, and we need to build it well, proficiently, without any gaps or leaks. So we know with awareness how it is happening. So with each of these four places, the Buddha asks us to do particular things. Like he says, with each of them, kaya or vedana, feeling, chitta or mind and dhamma, qualities that condition all these things. We need to do kaya, kaya anupassa, passi viharati, vedana, vedana anupassi, chitta, chitta anupassi, dhamma, dhamma anupassi. So it's the same way, being aware of the process as it is. Anupassi, it says, sometimes it's body in the body. So the little detail I found fresh was, it's not just finding a body in the body, but finding the process of what causes this body, how it is. And being aware of the process as it is happening without our own views or labels on it. Atapi can also mean burn, actually. So, you know, it burns out stuff we can get stuck in. So if you keep this sustained effort and maintain it, it might be tricky, but it will burn out something. When we try to log something like a stream, you know what happens. And life is also a stream. So if you block things, we know what happens. And it sounds really a lot of detail, but in doing of it, it can be simpler after some time. And doesn't seem very easy to do at first, but it is possible bit by bit, I think. So even if nothing seems to settle, we just carry on, because maybe it doesn't settle because we're just tired or we're not mindful. Or maybe sometimes when things don't settle, some kind of change is happening. Yeah. So instead of giving or getting fed up, we just carry on. And the last two words are abhijja dhammasa, which means that at this point in practice, we can really help us to be give a free choice. Because abhijja is sometimes called covetousness and dislike, you know, pushing and pulling. We need to know the process of how that's happening as well. So we have one option of what I want, you know, the wish inside, and the one outside is pulling us. So we're just pushing going on. And if it doesn't match, as I said, you get disappointment. But how we try to make it match, or when it starts matching, what happens if we don't get that disappointment and it matches, you know, what we're looking for, it matches our mental image. First, we get a moment, we welcome it. Whoa, that's lovely. Then, after welcoming it, we begin to get attached to it the second moment. You know, welcome it more, and then welcome it more and get really happy about it. And then really take delight in it. So that's called kaya, when we heap up something. We're heaping up this welcome, this delight, and then it becomes a abhijja, attachment. And we remain holding it. It becomes part of me. So with this, then you can also think of the opposite, you know, how rejecting something, getting really annoyed about it and not wanting it. So this abhijja dhammasa is going on. And I'm sure we've all experienced this, you know, just when you're walking on the high street, maybe not at the moment, but, you know, and there's shops and how the attentions are going and holding on to things. And one person recently who was practicing this said that he was able to not get attached to things out there. And he felt a lot of release and a great sense of freedom. So he could pay attention to what was happening in his immediate, the family and things when they were walking out for a walk in this case. And I thought that's really, it can be quite easy, you know, whether to keep it there is not easy, but that sort of knowing, understanding, jnana would stay, the knowing that it is possible. As the Buddha says, there are these four layers we need to do that with, and each layer is in relation to the other one. So although there's the outer, real world, if you like, or conventional world, and this first layer of me, within that, the first layer has a relationship, the second layer, which is the Vedana. The second layer is outer to the third layer, which is mind. The third layer is outer to the fourth layer, which is the Dhammas. And it's almost like peeling an onion in ourselves. And I found this drawing of somebody did, which I think is really beautiful. You know how it is when you peel an onion across, you get these rings, don't you? So you can see the layers. But I thought this little drawing showed these aspects of, you know, the inner outer a bit. So I chose this one. And it doesn't have to be four layers, because each layer has actually, later on we see in the sutta, many within it. But I also like that in the middle of it, there's this sort of what could be interpreted as a heart shape. And I thought that's, by chance, this image is really good, because it shows that with all this, we still need to keep an attitude of love and kindness in ourselves. And that's important to remember, because as I said earlier, you know, it's possible to become really serious or beat ourselves about things if they don't work. So if you want to just listen, and in whatever way you wish to listen and practice some of the things just said.
Evang me sutang ekang samayang bhagava kuru suviharati kammasa dhammang naam kurunang nigamo. Tatrako bhagava bhikkhu amantesi bhikkhavoti badanteti te bhikkhu bhagavato pachasosum bhagava etadvocha. Ekayano ayang bhikkave maggo sattanang visuddhiya soka pariddhavanang samatikkamaya dukkha domanassanang attagamaya nyayassa adhigamaya Nibbanas sacchikiriyaya yadidam chattaro satipatthana. Katame chattaro ida bhikkave bhikkhu kaye kayanupassi viharati Atapi sampajano satima vineya loke abhijado manasang. Vedanasu vedananupassi viharati Atapi sampajano satima vineya loke abhijjado manassam. Citte cittanupassi viharati atapi sampajano satima vineya loke abhijjado manassam. Dhammesu dhammanupassi viharati atapi sampajano satima vineya loke abhijjado manassam.
This is like having a little visit to touch all the points in ourselves, in a journey. And then here we are with each other. And that's the outer world. And they are both real. We need to look after them both. The Buddha never says leave the outer world because they are related. Recently, a friend shared some thoughts about his journey towards forgiveness and reconciliation. And he said the spark for it was this poem, which I've asked Robert to read, Rumi's poem. And it's about where the two worlds touch.
Out beyond ideas of wrongdoing and rightdoing, there is a field. I'll meet you there. When the soul lies down in that grass, the world is too full to talk about. Ideas, language, even the phrase each other doesn't make any sense. The breeze at dawn has secrets to tell you. Don't go back to sleep. People are going back and forth across the doorsill where the two worlds touch. The door is round and open. Don't go back to sleep.
So we don't go back to sleep. The sutta, having raised our awareness to these four levels with abhijja domnasa, not hankering after anything, the Buddha then asks us to look at dhammanupassana for the development of that fourth aspect in Anapanasati Sutta, contemplating impermanence and contemplating dissolution and then cessation and relinquishment. And that is investigation of Dhamma in relation to breathing. But here also we can do in relation to these four aspects. And the next section starts by saying how you get ready for a breathing practice. And normally, you know, we say go and it says go to a forest at the root of a tree and so on. We're already in practice, and the forest would be maybe slightly different here. Any inner thoughts that are coming, and the roots of the tree would be, do we want to go and find a particular place, or do you just want to go an empty space in your mind, sunyagari? And then do you want to sit upright in this cross-legged posture? So if you're just sitting on a chair, we make that attitude of firmness in our base and the upright attitude with mindfulness as our main aim. So we'll do the next part of the practice, the first four stages, having this attitude of these four places.
Katancha bhikkave bhikkhu kaye kayanupassi viharati. Idha bhikkave bhikkhu aranya gato va rukha moola gato va sunyagara gato va nisidati pallankam abhujitva ujunkayam panidhaya parimukham satin upatthapetva. So sato va assa sati, sato passa sati, digham va assa santo, digham assa samiti pajanati. Digham va passa santo, digham passa samiti pajanati. Rasaṃ vā assa santo rasaṃ assa sāmīti pajānāti. Rasaṃ vā passa santo rasaṃ passa sāmīti pajānāti. Sabbakaya patisangvedi Asasissamiti sikkhati Sabbakaya patisangvedi Pasasissamiti sikkhati Pasambhayam kaya sankharam Asasissamiti sikkhati Pasambhayam kaya sankharam Pasasissamiti sikkhati. Seyathapi bhikkave dakkho bhamakaro va bhamakarante vasiva. Dīghaṁ vā ancanto dīghaṁ ancāmīti pajānāti Rasaṁ vā ancanto rasaṁ ancāmīti pajānāti. Eva meva kho bhikkave bhikkhu Dīghaṁ vā assasanto dīghaṁ assasāmīti pajānāti Dīghaṁ vā passasanto dīghaṁ passasāmīti pajānāti Rasaṁ vā assasanto rasaṁ assasāmīti Pajanati. Rasaṁ vā passasanto rasaṁ passasāmīti pajānāti Sabbakāya paṭisaṁvedī assasissāmīti sikkhati Sabbakāya paṭisaṁvedī Pasasissamiti sikkhati Pasambhayam kaya sankharam Asasissamiti sikkhati Pasambhayam kaya sankharam Pasasissamiti sikkhati
You might have noticed that's repetition, really, the whole thing that the Buddha was saying. And that's where he's giving the example of an apprentice. Why is he giving this example of an apprentice? You know, but the explanation that was given was that it's like we are training our inner apprentice. And the inner apprentice is the one that is deepening our practice. We're using our knowing to train our inner apprentice. And as our inner apprentice gets trained, it becomes more efficient for us, more a way of life for us to live with this. And then the Buddha describes all the activities which we can use as a master and keeping an eye on this apprentice so that we can continue living, walking, and, you know, he doesn't give examples for all of them. He does give one for parts of the body and so on. And the last bit, that's repetition for all sections, for body, feeling, mind, and Dhamma, are that for each frame of reference or for each position, he repeats achatanga, bahidanga, outer, inner, like I said before, or both. Achatanga means going inwards. We went in to see the process. And when we've gone in to see the process, viharati doesn't mean we come out knowing the process. So viharati is for the life of the process. We let that process, that knowing, keep living. And coming with that knowing, keep living, we'll come out, bahida, and we know how it is when I was that process is active, even when you're outside. When we're in the world, we're still aware of how it is inside, how it is the ultimate reality. And then we're in, out, by the in and out, it says, of both. So being aware of both, while we are living in the world, doing whatever we are doing, we are also aware of the process of the feeling and the mind, not also at the same time, connected with what we're doing, of those four worlds, not for those frameworks. And when we can see this, then we can also lastly then become aware of the last aspect of that anapanasati I mentioned about things are arising, ceasing. So instead of just noticing the breathing going on all the time, we know breath goes in, it finishes, breath goes out, it finishes, a new breath goes in, a different breath. So we're seeing samudaya via Dhamma, the arising and ceasing. And we are developing the skill to know the conditions that make it arise and ones that make it cease. That's Dhammanusati. So we can see both equally. Then we can see the dissolution aspect in order to go to freedom. So there's the third chant to practice this final bit.
Iti ajjattaṃ vā kāyē kāyānupassī viharati bahiddhā vā kāyē kāyānupassī viharati ajjatta bahiddhā vā kāyē kāyānupassī viharati Samudaya dhammanupassī vā kāyasmin viharati Vaya dhammanupassī vā kāyasmin viharati Samudaya vaya dhammanupassī vā kāyasmin viharati Atthikāyoti vāpanasya satipacchupatthitā hoti yāvadeva jñānamattāya patissatimattāya anissito ca viharati naca kinci loke upādiyati evampi bhikkhave bhikkhu kāyē Kāyānupassī viharati.
If we listen to each of these, for that was for the kaya, body, or activity of body, you can listen to the mind of that, the feeling with that mind, and dhammas. And then the Buddha then does give all the details, which I won't go into now because there's no time, the whole framework of the sutta. But each step, he repeats all these things. And that I think is quite patient. And that's one quality of compassion, you know, patiently carrying on, giving the same similar instruction over and over again so that we can do the practice. I just want to wrap up by saying that, you know, there's these two realities I was talking about, the conventional and the ultimate realities. And I think perhaps the middle way is a bit like combination of the two. And we're learning to build a bridge between our two worlds. And the aspect of viharati, this way of learning in the sutta, would be not to abide in anywhere, not even abide on the bridge, you know, but to actually continuously bring process from one to the other, the understanding. And the bridge could be our creativity. We express it as compassion. We express it as sharing. Whatever we want to express, those are the aspects we would come out with. To selflessly give and trying to link towards either as a tunnel or as a bridge or whatever. But in the middle would be flowing whatever we want to express of what we've learned, either to help others, to help ourselves, or to let others grow, and so on. And I think it's a bit like skillful means is learning to build these connections for ourselves and some kind of integrations happening. And maybe you can find examples of that in your life. Quite a long time ago, I used to do a practice of mindfulness of death, you know, 10 years ago or so. And many things happened and it made me very awake, and I realized I mustn't leave anything undone and so on. So I started doing that to some extent, not too much. And then I just sort of left it, and I thought there must be more to this practice than that. I know it has this sense of urgency. But during this recent period, when there's so much awareness of death, I think that must have come back to me without being consciously aware of it. And I started having peaks in my body of almost like blood pressure rising and sometimes not. But I was feeling very calm and peaceful. So outwardly, this was happening in the body. Inwardly, I was feeling calm. And then one day I thought, no, there must be a reason for it. So I tried to do these four stages of practice in relation to that activity. And I found, there was a sort of very deep underlying anxiety going on. And so I tried many ways to deal with that and talk with others and so on. And then a few weeks ago, I thought, I'll just sit with it, stay with it. And I stayed with it from many directions, within and out, exploring what's causing it. What's the last time when you didn't feel like this? This very deep, it's not an obvious anxiety going on. And gradually I asked questions about when I was with people I could be with, which we can't be now. When I do Dhamma investigation, which I love doing, but you know, that's, I am doing something right now in this very moment. What is it that I'm not feeling that sense of deep anxiety? And in that moment, I realized it's actually because I'm alive and not dead. And so it seems to me now that the culmination of that practice is to recognize, for me anyway, that each moment I'm alive. So mindfulness of death means not to worry about that too much, but to be aware that it's the living that counts and to be in this living moment every moment. And the effect of that's quite amazing, because I used to have this for many years, actually, sort of deep pain in the shoulder, and it all dispersed like piti. And whether it's exactly what happened or not, I don't know. But then I also remembered reading Achan Chah's story a long time ago when he was a young monk, and he said he was doing his cemetery meditations, and at first he used to get a lot of fear. And then he decided he'd go with someone, and then it helped a bit. But then one day he decided he should actually try and just be there and stay there until it goes away, or find out why he's so afraid. And then he just sat there, and he sat through the fear. Then he realized many things, and he was never afraid. And I thought I was really compassionate of him to share that. And then just a few days ago, I was reading this Upakilesa Sutta, where the Buddha is saying how when he was in his, you know, final few days before enlightenment, when he was a bodhisattva, he's talking to the Aniruddhas, and he's saying about how, you know, he's getting, probably he was doing this last bit about dissolution and so on, he was getting Dhamma nimittas, if you like, or something, and all sorts of things happened. And I had a list of what he said, but I won't read it because it's rather long. But he goes through each time he sees it, he sort of decides not to do just by strong effort and atapi. He uses the same word, that sustained effort. And so he realizes there is a deficiency of energy, and then there's sloth and torpor, and then so on, until he comes to the point when he realizes he has fear. And I thought, that's quite interesting, because he says his fear arose as if, you know, he was going on a journey and there were murderers coming to leap out on both sides. And then he decided, well, he was just going to sit through it. And then after that, elation arose and so on. And then he kept abiding, diligent, and so on, until he got to the and of what he was trying to achieve. He says, Chakhu Dhapadi, you know, vision arose and knowledge arose and so on. So we know that in path of purification, and there is this aspect of getting to know fear. You mustn't be afraid to get to know fear. So I think part of this ability to stay, what he's saying in the practice of Chastan, is quite helpful in being with it, sampajanya, to get to know something, how it is, where it's coming from. And when we know where things are coming from, we know how to, what to do, really. And I just want to share this. Lance was really good at sharing these kind of principles of things. And he said, you know, sometimes in the beginning, we are sort of helping each other. A lot of things are going on. But there comes a time when he was saying, you know, there are many. This is just one. So many things in life. You are growing along with these little dots here, these ones. And then there are helpers coming, and say we are doing group work or whatever. Teachers are helping us. Or as a parent, we're helping our children. Or as children, our parents are helping us. And there's an interaction going on from outside. And that's like the first change, when something begins to change in us because of all this help and support. And then we continue in our life and path and so on. And then there comes a point when nothing that anybody does from outside can change. We have to go. We could either just go away for a bit, have a gap, you know, do something different. And I remember years ago reading in Abhidhamma that there are five hindrances, but at a later level, you discover there's a couple more, like boredom and after and avidya, you know, not knowing. And I wondered if this is what's happening, that there's a sense of boredom. So we go within, or we leave it for a while, like leaving that Maranusati practice. And something may change, a point of integration may come, or conditions change when it's possible to go further. Then you go to the next octave. Right? So you may recognize these in ourselves. And I often wonder if this is what happens, you know, when we're practicing, when we're doing group work. At first, we need each other's support, we need helpers. But then there comes a time, no amount of advice or help can change. We need to change our attitude, or we need to change something. And it's not necessarily conscious. It can happen in its own time. I think it's like anatta, that it happens. And when that happens, then after that, the person has the ability to be responsible for themselves in a different way. You know, like a child growing into an adult, or any process like that. And that different way would give them confidence to find out how to do things in life, to make those arches and bridges for ourselves, and how to express their creation or be compassionate and so on. Because at that point of difficulty, the person has to be really compassionate to themselves and really find different ways, creative ways, not necessarily creative in the sense of making something different from normal ways of being. And that interchange seems to be quite a helpful way of looking at it to me, where we can experience something. It almost feels like a sense of integration, but not conscious necessarily, because we can't make it happen. If it was conscious, we could do it, you know. I don't think it's conscious. It's things coming together, right time, right place, and so on. Just another final thought. I wondered, you know, when a person has a glimpse of this freedom, when that sort of process happened at a much higher octave level, or maybe not so high octave level. It doesn't mean in time, it doesn't mean moments in our life, really, because it's not progressive in relation to time. Dhamma is akaliko. It's not connected to time in the same way as the time we experience in the conventional world. Then maybe that's a moment of sotapani, of experiencing a moment of stream entry, just very small glimpse of something. Because at that moment, there's also a sense of freedom from what was there before, and things fall in place. And it's almost like, so we begin to learn the sense of responsibility, not taking things personally, but it is personal. So the personal is the sense of responsibility of living here, but not taking it personally is not letting wrong view about us, about our atta grow. And it seems like a nebulous kind of point. And that's like an image came that when a plant becomes a flower and then it begins to become a fruit, first moment of that path, if you like, it has to grow bigger. If it doesn't, if the person forgets about it, if the tree isn't fed anymore, the fruit will drop off without becoming ripe. So a person can have a moment of viewing something of freedom, but it may not ripen. But if we then continue to doing that over and over again, viharati, that knowing that we had, we continue living, keeping that alive and putting it into our life, then it will become a ripe mango, can be nourished, others and ourselves. Because, you know, when we chant the Sangha, about the Sangha, we say eight kinds of beings. There are four parts and four fruits. And I wondered, maybe it's like there's a glimpse of something, but then it needs to be cultivated, and then it becomes fruit of something, and then it's nourishing things. That the Buddha said about the Satipatthana Sutta. He says at one time, some people are asking him, lay people actually in this case, some performers, and he says, first of all, you protect earth yourself. Then you protect others. When you protect others, the others will protect you. And then you could protect others. I said a little bit of this before. But then the other thing he says is, in the same section in Samyutta Nikaya, that the Ananda asks him, you know, like last week it was mentioned just before, he said, who is going to be in charge when you're going to Parinibbana? And he said, I am not in charge. You know, and what you need to do is Dhamma's in charge. So if you practice Satipatthana all the way to the end and have enough compassion to teach others, then it will keep the Dhamma going for many other beings. So he says, this is the direct way. And also if you practice it to its completion, it will keep Dhamma going. That's where you look to keep Dhamma going, not to the Buddha. That was lovely, actually.
Thank you, Usha. That was lots and lots of stuff in there. And I often think about what we were able to share as a group to develop Samatha. And, you know, the support for the practice. And I often think now of people who are new to Samatha, and the huge admiration I feel for people who are, you know, developing the practice without all those benefits that we have. I was teaching in London for a few years, and I used to think about people who came to learn the practice and would go back to their own places where they lived alone, you know, and didn't have that same kind of support that we were so fortunate to have. So, yes, great gratitude for blessings that we can all share, we can all feel gratitude in our life. And,
Yes, it's very valuable having support of friends. And it's also, now I'm in a place where it's very different in Bath. It's also very valuable to go on your own. Because, you know, the Buddha says, you look for support and good friends and so on, which is helpful. If it's not possible to find that, live as a lone elephant in a forest. And that's why I actually haven't shared a slide, which is about the Eightfold Path. And I put this little elephant at the bottom, but you can see there's this elephant. Also, the Buddha often went and stayed in the forest. But in the sutta I've been talking about, the beginning is the kaya part, where when we are doing the, you know, what we're doing, we learn by using our energy, our right way of living, coordinating our hiri and otapa and learning about kamma. And we're also unfolding how we speak and the effort for right speech, we are learning kusla and kusla, not good, good, skillful, not so skillful. And we're also learning about sankhapa, our awareness of how our thoughts affect our mind. So this development of chitta. And then we're also learning about our views, mindfulness, which is based on this sutta. And that goes to developing wisdom. So the Eightfold Path is there. And in the Samyutta Nikaya, it says that when that matures and all the factors are mature of it, and then they're fulfilled, it says, I use the word mature, then you get two more factors, and it is a Tenfold Path. And those two are jnana and dasana, get to really know in the right way how things are and see how they are and go towards freedom, vimutti, which is a 10th path factor.
Hello, hello, Usha.
Hello.
And thank you very much for this wonderful talk. You mentioned personal responsibility.
Yes.
Which I personally link to the diligence, the effort we should put in that practice, in our practice. However, I struggle to relate this with anatta.
I am not sure if, is that the end of your question?
Yeah, could you please?
I'm not sure if effort is, of course we are responsible for making that effort, but I certainly use the word sustained, which is a gentle effort, because what I was going to show with a path, if I had more time, you know, vayama, it says sama vayama, it doesn't say effort in one sense. But these qualities of protecting ourselves from akusla are the two aspects of this effort, and cultivating kusla are the two other aspects of this effort. So I think when we are protecting and so on, it's probably quite firm responsibility, yes? It is responsibility, but when we are bringing in kusla and cultivating, it's like a plant. You can't force it to grow, but you look after it gently and carefully. It's a gentle effort, I think. And maintaining something is not even the same kind of effort, letting it grow. It's a very soft, sustained effort, I think. It's almost like making that effort from the fourth position. So the first position, you know, second, and the third one is a mind cultivating skillfulness. And the fourth one, maintaining something to know truth, to know dhammas. It's a gentle kind of effort. We can't force ourselves with it. And that's anatta. And that's also responsibility of how not to do. In that chain diagram I showed, Lance said once to me years ago, now learn how not to do.
Mm.
When we then allow somebody else, like parent allows the child, in Metta Sutta, it says you practice upekha. The parent, the helper, is cultivating the art of upekha, equipoise, you know, not interfering, but still watching like that assistant, you know, and the master in this, still watching, keeping a mindful awareness of it, but we're not interfering. And that's also responsibility. How letting somebody else or something else in ourselves become more responsible, truly responsible. And I think that's that transformation process where the outer conditions are the efforts, as I said, but the inner effort of maintaining it so it can happen is more gentle, I think, and allowing something. But it's also quite strong. It doesn't mean if you're gently soft, it's a mudu, it's a balance. Because in the Metta Sutta, it says, karaniya mata saku ujusha, we have to be upright, but also the word mudu is there. You know, there's a combination of uprightness and softness. And it isn't one or the other. I think they're both helping and supporting the metta function or the transformation function or whatever. They are qualities, they are not just for metta or just for that. There are qualities for any kind of growth and interaction and change to happen. And when the person changes, then the response aspect of responsibility might become different because they can now work with some more views, like you're going to the top of the hill and you stand at one place, you can see more. And then you go a bit further and you can see more. And you can do more. And that's the responsibility of taking it up. And then the helper has to give the opportunity for that to grow and let them be responsible. It's irresponsible for the helper to continue being responsible. But it's also irresponsible if the person gets there and doesn't cultivate it, because it will fall away. Or if it's in a change, it won't fall away, but it won't grow, you know, because it has already changed. So we can't hold on to responsibility. It's an attitude, isn't it? Sort of acceptance with knowing in the aspect of sotapanna, really, having complete faith or sadha, knowing that it's true. When you know it's true, you can't not know. Then you work from that position of knowing that it's true.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Is it better to guard someone's feelings with delusion or tell the truth knowing it will cause despair?
Yes, that's very tricky, isn't it? I don't think there's an ultimate answer, you know. In myself, I take it as a guide that if I'm not sure that I'm going to hurt the person, better to keep quiet until I find a way of saying it in a skillful way. So I think that's what upaya means, the Buddha's skillful means that I started with. He says it has to be the right time, the right place, and the right person. So, you know, sometimes we want to tell the truth, but it may not be the right time. It's best to keep quiet then. So the person doesn't mean physical person. It could be the same person, but their mind, state of mind would be different. We are born moment to moment, we become a different person. It's very quick, this process of how we are person to person, moment to moment. So that same person, after a few days, one day, the state of mind might be different. And you see, seems different. Maybe I could say it, but also how we say it. Compassion is very hard to do. And sometimes it's not conscious. Like I think the dustbin men are very compassionate because I feel their compassion. They might not do this job to be compassionate, but can you imagine if they didn't do that job, how bad our state would be? But we can't go and say to them, oh, are you practicing compassion? But we can appreciate in silence without saying. And I think there are times when we say and times they're not. Like another time a person asked me, a young man, he was an artist and he wanted to help people. I said, but you know, do you think making television programs helps people? And I said, well, there are very many lonely people in the world and we don't know, perhaps it does. It's their responsibility what to choose, but it certainly is a compassionate kind of a job in one way. But I can't say to this person, no, because I don't watch it. Or yes, because it's helpful. So I said both, you know, because there isn't a right fixed answer. And the choice, the responsibility is that person's then. But you can speak your truth, because I think that is true, you know, that it does help people and it hurts some people. Oh, there is no fixed way of doing things, I think. There's an interaction in everything, I think, and an openness. So that practice of compassion can be very subtle or even unconscious or subconscious. But in that situation you're asking, how to be compassionate. Sometimes it could be just giving them a beautiful gift or not saying too much, or, you know, could be anything. I think we might rely too much on words, and maybe it's not always necessary. The presence of someone in a peaceful state can help as well. And maybe that's why, you know, when meditators, it's by protecting yourself, you protect others. If a person can be peaceful in themselves, all the ones that might be around might sense a comfort and an ease in that situation. It protects everyone. So we don't always have to say or do.
Just a kind of point about the telling people things that might hurt them or might not be pleasant to hear. Around some of the early Dhamma wheels, there's a combination of spears and umbrellas, something with a bit sharp of wisdom and protective umbrellas. It reminds me of the way sometimes Lance would point out a point about you, which you might not want to hear, but also had a protective hand under you at the same time.
Yes.
Yeah. Both.
Yes, yes. A sort of care is very, yes. And it's not visible always, is it?
No.
So if you become aware of all the goodness we've cultivated, the marriage, the punya, by listening, not having wandering thoughts and things, and we'll finish by sharing our merit with all beings. So the verses are that we share this merit, and when we have something and we share it, it sort of is more punya, it gets bigger. So the more we share, the bigger it gets. So we're going to share with all deva realms, means heavenly happy beings, can be humans as well who are happy, good states, or sattas, beings who are stuck trying to get out, humans, animals, whatever. And then all the ones who are not in such happy states. So those are the first three. We are becoming aware of etavatacha ammehi sampadam punya sampadam. Sabbe deva anumodantu sabsampati sitya. Etavata chamehi sampadam punya sampadam. Sabbe satta anumodantu. And then itang menya sabbe bhuta, all the ones who are not in so good states, may they also benefit and find happier states and the causes for their unhappiness. Itang menyati nahotu sukita hontu nyatayo. Then we can think of all our relatives and friends related to. May they all be sukhi, may they all find happiness and freedom from suffering. Idang me punyang asava khayavang hotu. With this merit that we generate and allow to grow, may all our asavas, hindrances, negativities finish. We find the cause of them and know how to end them. Sab dukkha pramojantu, may all suffering cease by doing this work of merit. Sadhu, sadhu, sadhu.
Thank you, Usha. That was lots and lots of stuff in there. And I often think about what we were able to share as a group to develop Samatha. And, you know, the support for the practice. And I often think now of people who are new to Samatha and the huge admiration I feel for people who are, developing the practice without all those benefits that we have. I was teaching in London for a few years, and I used to think about people who came to learn the practice and would go back to their own places where they lived alone, you know, and didn't have that same kind of support that we were so fortunate to have. So, yes, great gratitude for blessings that we can all share, we can all feel gratitude in our life.
Yes, it's very valuable having support of friends. And it's also, now I'm in a place where it's very different in Bath. It's also very valuable to go on your own. Because, you know, the Buddha says, you look for support and good friends and so on, which is helpful. If it's not possible to find that, live as a lone elephant in a forest. And that's why I actually haven't shared a slide, which is about the Eightfold Path.